Hey y'all, hey, happy Friday Eve. Welcome everyone to Saki Speakeasy Podcast. I'm your host, Saki Speaks. Thanks for giving me a slice of your most precious commodity, your time. I truly, truly appreciate you. Y'all, please do me a favor and show my moderator, Love Jones, a little love, please, and thank you. She's not here yet. She's working, child. So when she catch a break in her busy office and folks leave her the fuck alone, she'll be over here to drop the links and greet everybody. But until then, I keep her in your prayers because she over there working, baby. My little sister be working, but when she get here, y'all love her up a little bit, all right? And please make sure that you like the video on your way in the door. And if you haven't already, please subscribe to the channel and click the notification bell and select all so you don't miss out on a single solitary chapter of these books, all right? So, with that being said, welcome to all of my new sippers and speakers. I truly appreciate you subscribing, and I hope that you find a reason to stick around. And welcome back to all of my returning sippers and speakers, those of you catching this on the replay. Thanks for coming back one more again to love up on your girl because y'all know I love the way that y'all love on me. All right, so listen. Before I acknowledge everybody in the building, there's a little bit of housekeeping that needs to take place. So about yesterday, okay? First of all, I hope everybody's having a great Thursday so far, but I need to let y'all know something. Number one, I'm probably one of the nicest content creators that you'll encounter on YouTube. And that's because I work hard to be that way. I come out here, I read books, I talk my shit. But y'all can never say that y'all have encountered drama over here because I don't do that. I could, but I make the choice not to. You know, and I think that people take my kindness as weakness. They take my silence as fear. And that's a mistake that they're making. But the people that know me behind the scenes, they know how I give it up. I choose not to present that aspect of my personality out here. That is a choice, okay? So on yesterday, there was an exchange, and it's always weird because let me explain something to y'all real quick, you know, if y'all don't mind. As an empath, I come out here and all I see are screen names and orbs of energy. I feel the shit that y'all are going through. I just don't say anything. I send y'all silent prayers. I really do. Because I know that y'all are human beings. Y'all are going through things. And y'all come out here for a good time. Some of you all have an escape from your life on YouTube. Your life is drama filled. And you like to come out here and see somebody else's shit. Because, hey, it makes your shit seem not that bad. I choose not to bring my shit to YouTube. I don't do that. But I'm a human being and I go through things just like y'all. Okay? So I come out here and I love on y'all because I know 9 times out of 10, ain't nobody told you that they give a fuck about you all day long. And those that have, you're probably questioning whether or not they really mean that shit. But understand something. Saki don't say shit that she don't mean. And she mean every motherfucking thing she say. Now, I just watched Tasha K here the other night call a woman a bitch and keep right on keeping on with her live stream as if nothing had happened. That's one of her subscribers. Now, it was a misunderstanding. Tasha was reading the chat and she misunderstood what the woman meant because understand something. If you make a statement in the chat without context, as a content creator, as I said, I'm still a human being up here, y'all. So I'm reading your shit and I'm reading it without context. So I have no choice but to put my context on it. And I don't mind people typing in the chat in all caps. But what you need to understand is that if you type in somebody's chat in all caps, number one, it's read as yelling, right? That's first. And you have to understand that there is a much higher propensity for them to misunderstand your intentions simply because you typed it in all caps. It's one thing if you're trying to let somebody know something, right? Like you're trying to say, hey, you know, I'm answering your question. The answer is, you know, yes, right? If I say, can y'all hear me? You type in all caps, yes, right? You want to be seen. But when you're saying something to get your point across, or when you're making a statement that may not mean any harm, if it's in all caps, a person could misinterpret that. Sometimes the misinterpretation is on their part simply because, hey, like I said, the content creator is a human being. You don't know what the fuck they got going on behind the scenes. The only difference between you and a content creator is that when they come to YouTube, they hit go live. And y'all hit live chat. That's the only difference. Other than that, we suffer through the same shit that y'all suffer through, sometimes worse. You just never know, right? And I'm not going to come out here and tell y'all my business, because I watch how y'all rip other motherfuckers to shreds that come out here and tell their business. I got several content creators that I watch, and people come in their chat and rip them to shreds simply because they choose to share their lives. Y'all pick people apart. I'm not saying y'all, my actual people in the chat, but I mean y'all as in subscribers, people who watch and view videos on YouTube. Y'all pick these people apart. You elevate them on a pedestal. And then you pick them apart for the first little thing that's going on in their lives. And like, these people are human beings just like y'all. Like, don't do that. So my thing is, I'm always nice. I may feel a way about something you do and never say something. But I come out here making the choice to have a good time. And I hope that I'm relieving, you know, somebody else's a little bit of their stress, their anxiety, their suffering when I come out here. But y'all don't know what the fuck I go through to come out here. It's days that I don't motherfucking feel like coming out here. I just don't. I don't make my living on YouTube. I got a whole life out here in the real world. I come to YouTube to read books and talk shit with y'all about fucking characters in books or about these fucking weird ass celebrities that do all types of fuck shit when they have millions and millions and millions of dollars in the bank. They should be off somewhere healing. But they doing fuck shit. So we talk about it. But if y'all know one thing about me, y'all know I talk about behavior and not the person. That's it. Except for these niggas. Y'all know I don't see shit for these black men. I don't give a fuck. I just don't care for them. Point blank, period. That ain't gonna change. That's not gonna change. But I come out here and I'm very nice. I need at least 2 to 3 cups of coffee before I come out here so that I'm not bombarded by everybody's energy. That's first. And at least a couple hours of meditation. I'm not talking about the meditation and prayer that I do for the people on my prayer list. I'm talking about after that, just so that I'm not just consumed with all of the energy that I feel when I come out to YouTube. Because whether I'm live streaming or in somebody else's chat, I feel the energy of everybody in the room. And it's like a whole bunch of toddlers just pulling at you, pulling at you, pulling. It just slaps you, slap, 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 slap. All day. So I literally have to psych myself up to come out here. So if I say something because I misunderstand what you say, if you choose to take it personal, that's on you. Okay? But there's a way to shut it down. Oh my goodness, I didn't know. I'm so sorry. It wasn't my intention to do whatever. But understand something. If you type in somebody's chat in all caps, there's the possibility that they could misunderstand what you're saying. And you can't take that personally because you're making the choice to type in all caps. It's just unprofessional. You do that in order to highlight something. You do that to say, hey, here's something that you need to pay attention to. If there's no reason for that, then it's read as yelling. I'm a human being, y'all. It's never my intention to come up here and embarrass anybody, to shame anybody, to make anybody feel bad. I love y'all. I love y'all because y'all living and breathing human beings, period. There ain't shit behind it and there ain't no expectation behind it. But I think some of y'all misunderstand. There are content creators out here that jap out on people all day long Why everybody got such a tender ass clip when it comes to me saying something? Oh, I never thought that she would say something like that to me. I never thought that she would, you know, actually set boundaries with me. I never thought that she would ever call me out on my shit. Why the fuck would you think that? I'm still a human being up here. I'm not a goddamn robot. I'm a human fucking being. And that's applicable to every content creator out here. We're human beings, y'all. With feelings and emotions, problems, issues, situations, and shit. So if we misinterpret something you're saying, when you type it in regular text, eat that. But if we misinterpret something that you're saying when you type it in all caps, you gotta own that one. Now, it's an asshole that doesn't apologize and say, you know what, baby girl, I misunderstood what you were saying. So I'm going to say it today. My apologies. I apologize for misunderstanding, for misinterpreting your intentions. But the onus of responsibility for making sure that somebody doesn't misinterpret what you're saying is you. Make sure that there's context there. Because all I see is an orb of energy, a screen name, and words. In a box. So when the exchange begins, it's real easy to nip it in the bud. I'm probably the most amenable person out here. Oh, girl, my bad. Damn, I'm tripping, right? Y'all have heard me do the girl shit. I thought you meant something else. The fuck? Okay, my bad. Forgive me. I apologize. But I'm not over here jacking out on my subscribers. I appreciate y'all being here. Y'all could be, YouTube has got, I don't know how many fucking channels. Y'all could be anywhere else right now, but y'all over here in the speakeasy with me. I appreciate that. I don't make a living out here. I'm not begging y'all for a motherfucking thing, but I'm up here ripping up my voice by choice. So if you tip, it's appreciated. It's not required. But my channel is unmonetized, so I'm not out here making a living. Like, don't disrespect me. If I say something to you, don't disrespect me, because it's never my intention to disrespect you. Y'all know I say all the time, this is a jamming-free environment. That means no judging and no shaming. And we just jammed it together and said there's no jamming over here. No judging and no shaming. So if anybody is off in their feelings, okay, I understand it, because I'm a human being and I would feel some type of way if somebody did the shit to me. I always put myself in the position of the other person. I literally do. If I had said what the fuck I was thinking during that exchange yesterday, all of y'all would have been like, oh, this bitch is crazy. Listen, I take my time and put sentences together so that I don't hurt anybody's feelings. And sometimes even that, because hey, no good deed goes unpunished. Sometimes even that is misunderstood. Some of y'all are so used to people japping out on y'all that y'all aren't satisfied until somebody come out of a ho, 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 Merry Christmas bag on your ass. That's what the fuck you understand. You understand when somebody cussing you smooth the fuck out. That you can appreciate and respect. But a nice bitch, a decent bitch, a considerate bitch up here, just literally taking your feelings into consideration. Oh, she weak. I can say whatever. Oh my God, how dare her? No, ma'am. This is a whole human being over here. You know, like don't misinterpret, you know, and take people's kindness for weakness, because this ain't that. And you really don't ever want to see that side of me. You really don't. Y'all caught a little piece of it. Oh, my mouthpiece is nasty in more ways than one, but stay out my goddamn business. My whole point is y'all don't want to see that side of me, and I don't ever want to show it to anybody. And it was more than one person that came to me after the live stream yesterday and was like, you know what? I totally understood where you were coming from. So I get it. I get it. I'm not up on YouTube to flex on nobody. I'm not calling y'all out of y'all names and mistreating y'all and disrespecting y'all. And all I ask is that you don't do that to me either. And we can get along like two motherfucking glazed donuts in a box. We really can't. I like glazed donuts. But we can get along like two glazed donuts in a box. We could just rub all on each other and get all luscious and lickety together. That sounds really sexual, but you know what the fuck I'm saying. Like, we can just have a good time, because that's why I come out to YouTube, to have a good fucking time. Like, y'all, I don't deal in drama if it ain't in a book or on a TV show or in a movie. I don't fucking do that shit over here. And I don't want it here. I understand how y'all go other places. I get it. Sometimes it's like, let me just see how many other motherfuckers is out here just fucked up too. I get that. But you're not going to find that over here. So if I ask something, just understand that, you know, the onus for making somebody understand what the fuck you mean is on you. And I felt like yesterday my message wasn't getting across, that it was being misinterpreted and misunderstood. And that's never my intention, because once a person gets in their feelings, their ears are no longer listening to what you're saying. They're hearing you. They're hearing you because their ears work, but they ain't listening to what the fuck you're saying, because all they're doing is feeling how the fuck they feel, which is embarrassed, you know, put out on Front Street. And my whole thing is, people have the right to set boundaries. And unfortunately, when you're on a live stream and you set boundaries for somebody on live stream, it's not just between you and the person. It's no longer a private exchange. It's a public exchange and everybody can see it. And I contemplated editing it out, but I feel like, why should I have to go through all of that when it don't even have to be a thing? So I didn't. I didn't. But it's never my intention to make anybody feel bad when they come to the speakeasy. It's really not. It ain't but a handful of us over here, for real. And I like it like that. I feel like I have a good rapport with everybody that drops in my chat. I'm building a rapport with some of you, but some of y'all have been here since day damn one. It's some day ones that don't even stop over here no more. But I'm sure they be in the clouds and the bushes every once in a while. And that's cool too. Hey, girl. Hey. Hey, sir. Right. It's nothing more than somebody got in their feelings. I said something they didn't like. The audacity of me to actually have feelings. The audacity of me to actually set boundaries. And you know who feels like that? People who don't set boundaries for themselves. People who don't stop and consider what it must be like to be on the receiving end of that. I'ma love y'all as long as y'all love me. And even when some of y'all don't, I'ma still love y'all, because that's just the type of bitch I am. And y'all ain't used to people like that. And that sucks for y'all. It really does. Because if I could grow up having the type of adult figure in my life that shit on me from the time she opened her fucking eyes until the time she closed them at night, and I'm still okay. Y'all listen, some of y'all ain't even, you know, and this is not, oh, let's compare traumas. No, this ain't that. This is just saying, hey, if I can make the choice, because it's absolutely a choice. If I can make the choice to overcome my shit, you can too. If I can make the choice to set aside some shit and be good and goddamn grown over here, you can too. Some shit just ain't even that big a deal. But I understand how you feel. And I'm saying to you, there's no reason for you to feel that way. Ain't nobody put a beam on you at all. Mm-mm. Nope. But it takes a grown woman to say, you know what, goddamn. You know? So this is my, you know what, goddamn. And whatever you decide to do, okay, I respect your decision. And for anybody going forward that ever encounters the same thing, ask yourself, what part did I play in that? What role did I play in that? Because it costs you absolutely nothing to hit pause on your own emotions and consider how the other motherfucker might feel. Flip the script and put yourself in their position. Oh, and then the tune of your motherfucking melody will change. It absolutely will. All right? So now, that was 24 minutes of you know, I don't know. Y'all, I hope it, you know, watered your grass a little bit. If not, you know, I don't know what Trump say, you know. I really don't, but that's it. All right. So hopefully, you know, people took notes and can say, well, damn, you know, let me stop and think about it. Because most content creators don't even acknowledge y'all. Like, that's real spit. They just don't. It's a whole lot of large content creators that never fucking acknowledge their people before. And y'all, believe it or not, there are large content creators that watch small content creators and steal their techniques, their sayings, their mannerisms, their methodologies. They do, and not steal them, because that's taking it away from them, but they copy them, they mimic them. And then y'all think, because y'all see it over there, oh, they got that wonderful idea, and that the smaller person must be mimicking them. No, God. Mm-mm. I just ain't before that many, as many eyes as they are. But they see, they dip in and say, oh, okay, I see she's doing that. Let me start doing that. But rewind it back to some of their video. They wasn't doing that shit before. Mm-mm. But I've always done it. Even did it when I wasn't even on my own channel. But you know, watch out there now. You got to know what you know in order to understand what that means. So my point is, you know, hey, some of these folks don't even acknowledge y'all. They don't pull up your comments unless you're fucking super chatting them or unless you sent them a Cash App. I pull y'all shit up just to make y'all fucking feel good, because I understand what it's like to live in a world where nobody motherfucking acknowledges your existence. And not only do they not acknowledge your existence, they don't give a motherfuck if you exist. When people don't show up in my chat, ask anybody that's ever been in here that dipped out for a minute what they get from me. Hey, girl. I hope all is well in your world. Haven't seen you in the speakeasy for a while. Hope everything is okay. Please know that I'm keeping you lifted and covered in prayer. And that's not no bullshit, because I pray for y'all. Even some of y'all that have snaked me behind the scenes. Even some of y'all that have talked shit behind my back that you don't know that I know what the fuck you said. I just choose not to say shit. You know why? Because the universe blessed me despite the fact that you spoke my name in rooms that I didn't even have access to. You didn't speak it in a good way either, bitch. But I see you. And it's okay. Mm-hmm. I wish you well. I do. And when you come over here, hey, girl, hey, hey. Because I'm not a shitty motherfucker. You know why? Because for every lollipop sucker, tussie roll motherfucker that speak ill against my name, the universe be like, clickety plow, here you go, bitch. These other motherfuckers are defending your name in places that you don't even know about. And I hear about that too. Here's a blessing for you right here. Right. Y'all don't understand. The universe ain't blessing no mess. Mm-mm. Y'all don't understand. Like, y'all pay attention to the wrong shit. Y'all pay attention to the wrong shit, because it's just, I call it a sour-ass childhood. If you had a sour-ass childhood and you never sought help, then you fuck around and grow up into a sour-ass adult. You expect to get fucked over, fucked around, fucked with, right? And you become a tight-ass individual. That's not me. I worked hard to heal my shit. Very fucking hard. And I don't let people play on my top. I don't. I'm a sweetheart because I love everybody until they give me a reason not to. You know, the agape love that Christians like to say that they have, but they really fucking don't. They really don't have it. Because I'd be concerned about motherfuckers that snake me. I'm talking snake me, anaconda style. When I see them getting raked over the coals by somebody else, I be like, God damn, I know that had to hurt. I'm y'all that get killed for them. Like, for real. I'm that person. And so the universe always looks out for me. Don't get it twisted. So anyway, enough of that, because y'all ain't here for that type of teaching, and y'all ain't ready for it. And I say that meaning, when I say y'all ain't ready for that type of teaching, the shit that I have to say that really fucking matters, the shit that I'll eventually say whenever I finally monetize this channel and put that on my membership tier, is going to be the shit that's going to force you to stand in your fucking mirror and take a good long look at who the fuck you be. Because some of y'all don't even know. And you ain't ready for that because you're going to have to own some shit. You're going to have to acknowledge some shit. You're going to have to accept some shit. You're going to have to heal some shit. And some of y'all going to back away from that mirror saying, nah, maybe next year, but this year I ain't ready to do that. You ain't grown enough yet, even at your big age. And I'm not telling you about what the fuck I heard. I'm telling you about what I know because I'm good at my job outside of YouTube. How did I get so good at that motherfucker? Because I went through it. Down in the trenches. For real. Y'all don't know me. Y'all know what other motherfuckers out here that profess to know me have said. And them motherfuckers don't know themselves. So how the fuck they know me? Think about that for a minute. Think about that for a minute. Don't ever go off of what you hear. Go off of what a motherfucker show you. Because a pair of lips will tell you any motherfucking thing. They'll sing a melody so sweet, tickling your eardrums, and it's all bullshit. Trust and believe. You don't never want to fuck with the motherfucker that tell you what you want to hear. You want to ride with the bitch that tell you what you need to hear. That's the motherfucker that's got your back. The bitch that'll say, hey, come here. Let me holler at you for a minute. and drop a gem in your fucking earlobe that'll shine so bright, it'll make your mama say, God damn. What you doing? Show me how to do whatever you doing. Y'all ain't ready. You're not ready because it's going to cause you to take a long, hard look at how you giving it up out here. And I'm not just talking about on YouTube. I'm talking about in the world, in your relationships, at your job, in your neighborhood, with your children, young and old. That part. Everybody ain't ready for that. You know, some people out here are, boy, anyway, let me stop because like this will get away from its intended purpose and it'll become something else. And like I said, you know, I half the if I said on YouTube half the shit I thought, some of y'all would be in tears and the rest of y'all would be like, man, fuck up. Why? Because you're not ready. That's the only time you would ever say, man, fuck up. Because I'm holding that mirror up to you. All these other motherfuckers is out here doing this fucking knick-knack, paddywhack ass bullshit. I don't do that. I don't do that. If you're blessed enough to have a conversation with me, you're going to walk away up fucking lifted. Because that's how I give it up. For real. And I say blessed enough, meaning the universe got to favor you enough because you have put out the call. You place the order to the Amazon of the universe. Give me a sign. Show me what I need to see. Tell me what I'm doing wrong. And then plickety plow, you'll be in an environment where I'm giving it up like that. That's what I mean by blessed enough. Trust me, you're going to walk away uplifted. That's just all I do. I pour into motherfuckers all the time, all day. And then sit down early in the morning and fill up my own fucking cup. Right. I got people that pour into me too. They do. And just like y'all, sometimes I listen, sometimes I don't. It just is what it is because I'm a human being just like y'all. And people come up here and sell y'all a fucking fantasy, tell y'all a bunch of bullshit. You're not made better after listening to them. You were entertained. Okay. You know, I don't know what else to say. Anyway, so let me see who's here, child, because, you know, people got shit to do. And I said I was only going to be up here for a couple of hours per video because I don't like for it to be long. But that is, consider the content creator when you're in their chat box and what they must be thinking and feeling. I know being considerate is like a foreign thing to other people because some people are just so focused on whatever it is that's going on in their craniums, they don't stop and consider what the other person might be going through. But it's a whole lot of people doing a whole lot of suffering out here, y'all. Show them a little grace. Show them a little consideration. Treat them the way you would want a motherfucker to treat you. That's all I'm saying. Like, those are not just words, y'all. That's one to grow on. All right? So, Hashitashi Grasshopper. Hey, girl. Hey. Welcome, darling. Hey, learning. Thank you so much for being here, darling. I appreciate you. I understand you in the clouds, child. You working. Get your paper. And please, I responded. Go over there and take a look and let them know. Please, ma'am. Hey, Marva. Good afternoon, darling. Welcome. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you. Hey, Shanae. Hey, girl. Hey, welcome. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Hey, Kay. Now we in here like swimwear. Hey, Kay. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Hey, Nikweta. Welcome, darling. Happy Thursday, darling. Thank you so much. Not with the floaties, the drinks, and the shades. I appreciate you being here, darling. Welcome. Oh, my goodness. I think I got everybody. Well, wait, let me keep going. Wait a minute. Uh-oh. I'm going. There's Love Jones. Hey, little sis. Welcome, darling. Thank you so much for being here. I know you're working hard, child. I wasn't even expecting for you to drop in here at all, but I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. Mel J is in the building. You finally made a live stream. Oh, you are welcome, darling. Thank you for being a part of the Speakeasy. I appreciate you. Welcome. I hope you're having a great day. All right. Let me keep going here. So we get Choco Chip done slid up in here, y'all. And she got a whole red wagon full of good vibes. Welcome, darling. Thank you so much for being here, lovey. You know I appreciate you. Welcome. All right. So wait a minute. So Kay said, hey, Saki girl, I followed your Instagram because per usual, I was behind yesterday and the live went off. Thank you for accepting my request. You're welcome, darling. You are quite welcome. You're quite welcome. You know, I did that. I made it private because I really, it's only a couple of men that follow me on Instagram. I used to put, you know, little stuff out there and women were, you know, sharing their lives and experiences. And I just felt like, you know, it needs to be a safe space because men, yeah, they don't really understand how to interpret, you know, women things. And that's a character flaw. No, not a character flaw. It's a design flaw. It's a design flaw in men. They were just designed all fucked up. That's why they were first. You know, they were the prototype. And then they got all fucked up. And then, you know, listen, the creator said, let me get this fucking shit right. And then we showed up. And, well, you know, hey. But, of course, you know, the original had to run amok and fuck that all up. Figured out they had a piece that could be inserted into us and just fuck our minds all up. That's a design flaw in us, child. Something about, you know, being on the receiving end of their insertable have us going, right? But listen, but once you learn, you be like, you know what? Fuck that. I'm going to get that. I'll take your insertable. But the rest of that bullshit, you keep that over there, right? But you got to learn, child. That's when you get good and grown. You can realize and learn how to take dick, but not the bullshit that comes behind it. How about that? Argue with your weird ass neighbors, but not me, because I said what I said. Anyway, all right. So, yes, I am. I'm going to get my timestamp together. I hope that you all understood where I was coming from. Not only did you hear it because your ears work, I hope you were listening and I hope you felt me. And, you know, it's through hearing and feeling that we understand. You know, I hope you internalized it and you can, you know, take from it what you will. Because, listen, everybody don't like mustard on their hot dog and everybody don't like mayonnaise on their hamburger. But you know what? A good chef will fix it however you want it. So that's me. All right. Let me get into this book, child, because we are 38 minutes in here. And, yeah, we ain't even started the damn book. So. Yeah, I don't want to keep y'all all day, but I am going to come back later. I just couldn't come back yesterday because I felt some type of motherfucking way and I'm okay with that. I'm a human being and I'm allowed to feel. I just don't like being misunderstood. And that's why I didn't come back. I had to get that energy up off. All right. Chapter 3. What the fuck, man? Messiah shouted as the momentum of the turn sent him flying across the back of the van. He collided with the wall so viciously that he felt the taste of blood fill his mouth. He had no idea where the police were taking him, but he knew that this was bad. The speeds at which he was being driven and sharp turns and hard stops were torture. The cops had left him cuffed and intentionally left his seatbelt unfastened. It didn't matter how much Messiah tried to brace himself. The twists and turns sent him crashing into steel walls every few seconds. This ride just may kill him. With his hands behind his back, he couldn't even attempt to hold on. He was at their mercy. They would show none until he gave them what they wanted. The next turn sent him violently crashing into the steel bench and then snatched him clear across the space. Fuck! He screamed as blood filled his vision, his forehead splitting open from the impact. By the time they pulled the police van over, Messiah was on the floor, conscious, but groaning in excruciating pain. Get him up, the detective said. Messiah was bloody as they dragged him out of the back of the van. The deserted field was every indication of what would happen next. Now, it made sense why they hadn't processed him into the system all night. They hadn't taken one fingerprint, hadn't conducted one mugshot. They had just let him sit because they wanted no proof that he had been there. You should really start talking, the detective said. Whatever you plan to do out here, you're gonna have to see that all the way through, Messiah said, spitting out a mouthful of blood, only for it to fill with more. He was leaking everywhere. You'll die for him? For a man who has poisoned women and kids and the community for years? The detective tested. Messiah tried to pick up his head, but he was sure one of his shoulders had been dislocated from the drive. On every day of any week, you're gonna have to kill me, Messiah said. I'm ready to die about mine. Do what you gotta do. The history between them didn't matter. Ethic and Messiah were complicated, full of love and betrayal, all in the same breath. But Ethic was the single most important man in Messiah's life. He hadn't been able to betray him before, and the loyalty had only grown over the years. He wouldn't fold now. Even with the trust Ethic had lost in him, Messiah still couldn't fold. He was solid, a dependable lieutenant to a street king, despite a sordid history. The detective looked at his partner and nodded. Tough guy, he said. Should be fun. Make them talk. Let's see how strong that loyalty is. And there's a break in the chapter. Child, listen. I keep telling y'all, it ain't no good in some of these men out here. You know? No. Sometimes it'll do that. Just refresh. Hold on, y'all. No. Just refresh it. It's a flaw between YouTube and StreamYard. But if you refresh, go out all the way out and come back in. If you go all the way out and come back in, the comments should all come back. All right. Hendrix sat with his head resting on his stacked fist as he thought of everything outside these walls. I know my smart girl mad as fuck, man, he thought. I ain't never getting to that door with her. He had been thinking of ending things with Bella for weeks. She was simply too good for him. She's hella smart, hella loyal, too. She gonna do some dope shit, and I'm just a hood nigga that's gonna hold her back. After this, Ethic ain't gonna let me near her anyway. Henny had been feeling inadequate lately, like the dreams Bella had him trying on were too big for him. It was the reason why he had stepped both feet into the game, copping product and making runs for the crew to prove his value to their organization. The more money he got with them, the more he knew that he and Bella would end. She wouldn't understand his reasons, and he wasn't looking to explain them to her. They were from two different worlds, and although they had their eye on the same destination, they had to walk different paths to get there. His arrest was like a pin to a balloon. It deflated every dream he had imagined with Bella. There would be no evolving love story. With the amount of product they had caught him with, Henny knew they were going to lock him away. The thought made his eyes burn. The growl of his stomach was overpowered by the sickness he felt at his core. He was terrified. He was trying his hardest to be like Ethic and Messiah. He watched them closely in that cell. He had seen no fear in them, not even a hint of it. So he had faked it too. He pretended to be okay, but he wasn't. Hendrix was a boy masquerading as a man, but in the eyes of the law, he was a menace. He was shivering as the air conditioning flowed into the room. His clothes clung to his body, the wetness making the air conditioning feel like pure ice water running through his veins. They had waterboarded him for close to an hour. A soundproof basement, a single chair, a steel table that he was cuffed to, and one light bulb hanging from the ceiling. That's all that filled this dark, dank room. He could hear mice scurrying in the corners of the room where the pathetic light bulb's glow didn't reach. He was breaking down in this room. Fear and desertion made it feel like the cops were pulling him away from his pack, away from Ethic. He was left to figure out survival on his own. Hendrix was a cub without the protection of a full-grown lion. He needed help. He needed someone to get him out of there. way they had abused him with fists, or abused him first with phone books, then with tasers, and then with a burlap bag and what felt like an ocean's worth of water. Henny was broken. He just wanted to go home. The door to the basement opened and the detective walked into the room. "I want a lawyer, man," Hendricks said. "You can't just keep me down here." "You're your own way out," the detective replied. "Nobody took a mug shot of you, no fingerprints. Technically, we don't even have you in our possession. Think about that for a minute, young man. You don't exist unless we say you exist behind these walls. You can go home. I'd love to let you go home, but you gotta give me something first," the detective said. "That's horrible, the way they're doing him, but, you know, what can you do?" "I don't know nothing about what you're talking about. I date Mr. Okafor's daughter. That's it. I was only over there to see her," he said, sticking to his story. "Fucking broken record," the detective muttered in frustration. He pulled out a mugshot and placed it up to Hendrix's face, grabbing his hair with one tight fist, forcing him to look at the picture. "What about her? You know her?" Hendrix's mother was before him. It had been a while since they had spoken. It had been even longer since he had seen her. "She got picked up down there on Avenue B. High out of her mind. This is her third offense. Judge will probably give her a few," the detective said. Hendrix's heart felt like it was split open. Avenue B was a known prostitute alley. And if she was arrested there, it meant his mother was selling pussy to support her drug habit. A mixture of shame and rage filled him, but the most overwhelming emotion of them all was helplessness. His mother had been breaking his heart for as long as he could remember. Promises of getting clean were always broken by her love for dope. Hendrix desperately wanted to know what it was like to be someone's first love, to be loved so wholly that nothing else came before him. A boy normally received that from his mother. Hendrix never had, because crack and heroin always came first. It's a whole lot of kids out there like that. Catch. He had learned that lesson the hard way over the years, and seeing her mugshot before him was only another stab to his ego as her son. He prayed nightly for a mother who was strong enough to beat addiction for him. He wanted to be a kid she could love enough to use as motivation to get her life straight, but he was never enough. The resentment he had built up over the years sat in the pit of him like bricks weighing down a sinking boat. His jaw locked as he fought the emotion building. It felt like hurricane force winds were blowing through his chest. He fought a good fight as he willed himself not to care. "Nobody ever gave a fuck about you. That ain't even your mama. You don't even know the lady in that picture." Only it was his mama. Despite the weight loss, the skin that had seen better days, and the matted hair on her head, the eyes were the same. Eyes he had always found beautiful ever since she had held him to his chest as a baby boy. I think she meant to her chest. She was his mama, and she was strung out and the shit hurt. The heaviest teardrops fell from his eyes as he fought his own psyche, trying to convince himself not to care. "You tell us what we want to know. Maybe it could help your mother," the detective pushed. "You can take your mother and go home. Leave us to deal with the real bad guy in this situation." Hendrix couldn't tear his eyes away from the picture. "I don't know shit about what you talking," he said, voice racked with disappointment and sadness. "That's too bad, son," the detective said. "You sure he would do the same for you? Give up his life with his wife, with his children, with his blood family for you? Then, like Ezra Okafor, use boys like you. You take all the risk for a little pocket money and status while he sits upon the mountaintop, sending his kids to fancy schools, unreachable and untouchable." Hendrix stared the detective directly in the eyes and said, "Fuck you." It was the last thing he said before he was hit with a taser to the neck, sending his world fading to black. "Little piece of shit," the detective spat. And there's a break in the chapter. Child, listen. Oh, my God. It's okay. Don't worry about it. I'm sorry, y'all. Because they disappear over time. But they're all still here in StreamYard. So sometimes you can see them and sometimes you can't. Don't worry about it. I got it. I'm sorry, y'all. All right, because there was a little break in the chapter. Let me see. YouTube tripping. Sometimes, y'all, the comments will disappear. And you got to back all the way out and come back in. Yeah. The YouTube be tripping sometimes. Hey, KTG. Happy Thursday, darling. Welcome. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. All right. Please take me to ethics, Morgan said. Alani's pregnant. She's been calling me all night. Bella and Easy are scared. I should be there for them right now. How does that work, Mo? You run to your family and what? Tell them everything? Do you really think that helps? Getting rid of me doesn't get rid of your problem. I've taken precautions. If anything happens to me, this all gets worse for you, Bash said as he drove. I know what I've done and what's at stake. Hopelessness loomed over her. She wanted to ask for help. She wanted to tell it all, but every time she built up the courage to tell someone, Bash doubled down on his threats. First, it was her schooling. When she built up enough moxie to follow her heart anyway, Bash put ethics freedom on the table. And just to ensure she understood her position, he added her children in the pile of collateral damage. I just want to be there for them. And pretend like you aren't the reason why their world is falling apart. You're going to go there and look that woman in the face and cry with her, all the while pretending like you don't know why he's in jail. You're a sick individual, Morgan, Bash snickered. You don't even like her, do you? You tolerate her. You're so obsessed with ethic that you hate his wife. You chase anything that reminds you of the way he loves. Is that why you can't be happy with me? Because I'm nothing like him? Because you have daddy issues? Am I not street enough? Not damaged enough? Pause. He tells her that she's sick, but he's so sick that he's done all of this shit just to keep her in line. Nigga, you're the sickest. If she's sick, motherfucker, you're infected. Good. Googly moogly. Told you, that's that gaslighting shit that these niggas do. Especially BNB. That's bitch nigga Bash for those of y'all that don't know. Right, Shanae. Henny really don't know what they're talking about. He's not lying. He has no idea. He don't know that side of ethic. He don't know. Ethic just gave him a job. Child, listen. If this shit don't get sorted out, ugh. She didn't expect Bash to understand. There weren't many who could fathom the bond Morgan and Ethic shared. She had put him in jeopardy, and if he lost everything because of her, Morgan would never forgive herself. Blackmailing someone so they can't leave sounds damaged to me, Morgan whispered. If I don't show up for this, Ethic will know something is wrong. He'll think something has happened to me. Morgan felt sick to her stomach when Bash didn't change course. They drove in silence all the way to her apartment. Grab some stuff for you and the twins. We're going to my family's estate, Bash said. She nodded because she didn't know what else she could do but be agreeable. Morgan didn't even want to leave her kids in the car with him while she packed. She shook Masari awake and picked up a sleeping Yara. Bash reached for her daughter and she maneuvered out of his reach. I got it, she said, defensive, untrusting. Morgan's emotional pain overpowered anything physical she felt, but everything was battered. From her rib cage to her soul, everything ached. Bash didn't push as he followed her up the walkway to her building. Mo! The sound of Nair's voice breaking through the silent night was like a lever to her tears. She turned toward him and practically ran into his arms. We've been calling you all night, Nair said. Morgan cried on his shoulder. It was the first time she had felt safe all night. Ethics in trouble. Alani needs you home, Nair said. Get it out right here. So when you get there, you can be strong. You hear me? And if you ain't strong, I'm gonna be right there. I got you, Mo. This is all my fault, she cried. Nah, Mo, it ain't. Everybody has their day of reckoning. Nothing goes unseen and nothing is left unaddressed before God. Gonna figure it out, though. That's my word. We gonna get him out of there, Nair said, gripping her chin and bending his neck to look in her eyes. Morgan nodded and Nair frowned as he bent to pick up Masari, who was glued to Morgan's leg. I know, Nair said. Anyone who had ever spent even a second around Ethic could identify the love he had for his family. If anything happened to Ethic, so many people's lives would be left in shambles. You're shaking, Nair said. I just want to go home, Morgan said, finding solace in his presence, a safety that was elusive, and a trust that wouldn't flee. She knew if she left there with Nair, she would be safe. She may even be able to ask him for help. He wouldn't judge. He wouldn't hate her for making a selfish mistake. Nah, I'll drive him, Bash interjected. We were just headed that way. Nair nodded. I gotta go down to the jail, so that works. We can ride with you, Mo pressed. I'll meet you back at the house. If I don't get down there, things can get rough for Ethic inside. They need to know the church is invested in this arrest, Nair said. Nair shifted his focus to Bash. Get them there safely, G. I don't really play about her. Nair extended his hand and Bash accepted it, shaking it. That makes two of us, Bash replied. Ooh, this motherfucker, yo. Oh my God. I'm so fucking sick of this nigga, yo. Nair kissed Morgan's cheek. I'ma call as soon as I hear something. Pick up your phone, Mo. Take it easy on Alani. She's trying to act like she's not falling apart, but she's hurting. When he walked away, Morgan felt sick. Bash gripped her side, putting pressure on her injured abdomen, reminding her to play her role. Get it together. You know what happens if you don't. I want them to kill this motherfucker. I want them to kill him slowly. Oh my God. It's a break in the chapter. I want him dead, y'all. I really do. I want him to have such a slow and painful death. I really do. Like, poke his eyes out, cut his tummy out, cut his fingers off. Oh! Alani sat on the couch holding her wedding album in her hands, fingers trembling as she flipped through the memories. Ezra was on every page, and every time she laid eyes on him, her heart skipped a beat. She didn't even know how they had gotten here. In no logical world should she exist in his space, but his space was the only place she wanted to be. Everything about their relationship was unconventional, but their love was a tradition that couldn't be more classic. They were like those old black and white romance movies. They felt like a 90s R&B groove on a Sunday morning. Ethic and Alani had written a love story against all odds. Please, she thought, silently begging for a resolution. The Ring doorbell alerted her that there was movement at her front gate, and she opened the app urgently. Her heart ached in the seconds it took to pull up the footage. She was relieved to see Bash's car pulling onto their property. Morgan and her babies would make her feel less alone tonight. She pulled herself to her feet and lost breath as she struggled to the door. The discomfort of her third trimester made her feel like she was sprinting as she made her way to greet them. Opening the door, she waited as the car pulled to a stop in the middle of the circular driveway. Morgan's melancholy could be felt before she even stepped out. As soon as she got out, Alani lifted praying hands to her lips. Thank you for coming. And Mo, you don't even know how much I need you right now. I can guarantee I need you more, Morgan said softly. She was shrinking by the minute, breaking down inside. Have you heard anything? Not yet. I couldn't even find him in the system when I went down there, Alani said. Nye's gonna see what he can find out. What does that mean? Morgan asked, turning to Bash, who was pulling Yara from the back seat of his car. It means a lot of people have to do their job to make sure he comes home safe, Bash said. The hidden innuendo in the threat made Morgan breathless. Nothing had ever felt so cruel. Alani missed it because he was right. Lawyers, cops, judges, they all had to conduct themselves with justice in mind in order for Ethic to have a fair shot of being released. Human bias couldn't get in the way, but just from her interactions at the station tonight, she had a feeling that they were in for the fight of their lives. I thought the kids were with Messiah, Alani said. He was arrested tonight, too, Morgan answered. They took him away in front of them. This really can't get any worse, Alani whispered. Let's get the kids in the house and in the bed. They've been through enough tonight. She went to retrieve Masari, who was sleeping in the back seat. I can get him, Mo said. I got him, Alani. Oh, no, I got him. Alani carried him into the house and laid him on the couch. You can give me her, too. She reached for Yara and then cozied up beside them. I need all the energy my babies have to give right now. You two can head up and get some rest. She pulled the oversized throw over their bodies. We all need it. Help is coming in the morning. Help? Bash asked. Nair thinks there is someone pulling strings on this from the inside, probably a cop with a grudge or something. I don't know, but we have strings to pull too. They'll have to bury me before I leave him in there, Alani said. The way they put those cuffs on him, the way they manhandle Hendrix. Hendrix got arrested too? Morgan's shock couldn't be hidden. So many people were affected by her decisions, people who didn't deserve it. Bash, can you excuse us? Alani asked. Bash hesitated and shot a glance at Morgan before ascending the stairs. I still don't know what they're holding Ezra for, but my gut is telling me it's about my baby, Mo. If it's about Kinsey and this goes to court, you'll have to relive a nightmare. We all will have to go back in time and relive it. If this gets bad, it's going to rip this family apart. You and I can't be at odds. We can't let anything or anyone take us back to the place we've grown from, Mo. I love you. I'm so sorry about what my brother did to you and how we entered each other's lives, but we're family now. I just want you to know that no matter how ugly this gets or how bad it hurts when the past and our secrets are put on trial for people to judge, I love you, and we're family, and Ezra will need us to remember that. Morgan nodded, eyes weighted with emotion, heart burdened with guilt. Alani hugged Morgan tightly, and Morgan winced, pulling back. You okay? Alani asked. Morgan shook her head and then nodded, changing her mind in a millisecond about asking for help. Oh, what a fucking moron! Oh, my God. Alani couldn't help her. No one could. The amount of power the Fredericks had was unequal to the amount of power Ethic had. Street politics couldn't measure up. Bullshit, girl. You don't even... anyway, Child, listen, people be thinking that shit, but street politics, street folks got people on the inside too, bitch. Okay? Not just Bash and his uptight ass mama. She had to fix this herself, and the best way to do that was from the inside. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen. This is insane. All right, let me see. All right, did it fix now? I think it should have fixed by now. Y'all give me 1 second. I need to turn this air down a little bit. I'm so annoyed by this fucking Bash nigga that I done got warm, child. And it's hotter than the devil's butthole outside. Again, y'all. I don't even understand. Yesterday, do y'all know? Let me just tell y'all this. You know, we cooling out over here. So yesterday, the high was 106 and it felt like 114. But let me hip y'all to something. Last night at about 10:30, it was still 97 down here in Texas. And with the heat index, it felt like 103. At night, y'all. At night. If this ain't the devil's asshole, I don't know what is, because right now, in my neck of the woods in Texas, is 94 degrees. And with the heat index, it feels like 104. And guess what the high today is? 106. So if the heat index is 10 degrees above the actual temperature, when it's 106, that means it's going to feel like 116. Why is it this hot in Texas? Why? I mean, I'm not shocked because it's always been hot down here, but this is insane in the fucking membrane. All right, let me turn this air. I'll be right back. All right, sorry, y'all. I decided to go and take a little swallow of something cold to drink, too. Cool me off from the inside. All right. So let me get my timestamp for this next chapter, child, because listen, this is insane. Trying to get my timestamp to go right. Let me just pop it up here and do it like that. Y'all listen. I feel like this book is going to be the one that really is going to make me cry. And it better not, Ashley. Because girl, chapter 4. If my dad goes to jail, does that mean I'm the man of the house? Easy's question cut through Alani like glass, and she had to take a moment to stop her eyes from tearing before turning toward him. She gripped the edge of the wooden seat before her as she waited anxiously for the court proceedings to begin. No, baby, you're a boy. Nothing's going to make you become a man before it's your time. Daddy is going to be okay. This is all a misunderstanding, and we're going to clear it up soon, she reassured. Girl, Alani, I hope so, because listen, Heifer. Mm-mm. What the hell? Hold on, y'all. What is happening? I don't know, y'all. Something was happening with this thing. StreamYard is tripping. YouTube is tripping. It's okay. I got it. Alani had wanted to leave Easy home, but the attorney Zaya had sent had insisted that his entire family be present when he appeared before the court. Easy gripped Alani's hand and leaned his head against her body. Bella sat on her other side. Morgan sat beside Bella, and Bash capped off the end. Why the fuck is he there, fucking asshole? Nair sat in the row in front of them beside his father and Zora. She was anxious to plant eyes on her husband. They didn't go days without speaking, without contact. It felt like a lifetime. When the side door opened, Alani's heart stalled. Ethic walked in wearing an orange jumpsuit, shackled at the wrists and the feet. Where is his suit? The lawyer told me to drop off a suit for him to wear to court, Alani whispered. His feet stopped moving when he spotted his family and their eyes met. A thousand I love thee. Flew through the midair just to reach one another. She could see the sorrow in him, the regret, the apology. No one else would notice the chip in his armor, but Alani saw it clearly. She knew him too well to miss it. This was bad. She had known it was when the police had shown up to their home, but seeing him now in police custody, she could tell that he was worried. Whatever storm had ended their life was far from over. Nah, he looks like a criminal. Where is his suit? Alani leaned forward, tapping his shoulder, whispering in Nair's ear. I'm sure that's on purpose, Nair said. They always want to make sure a nigga look like a nigga. All rise. Court is in session. Honorable Judge Mitchell presiding, the bailiff announced. Alani lifted from her seat. Where's Henny? Bella asked. The judge won't see them together, baby girl. We'll have to wait for his case to be called, Alani said. We're going to wait, right? Alani heard the worry. She grabbed Bella's hands as they stood side by side. Yes, B. We're going to wait. The judge entered the room and took a seat. Alani's faith dwindled when she saw the elderly white man. The fate of a black man always somehow came down to being in the hands of a white man. You may be seated, the judge said. Everyone in attendance sat, and Alani hoped Ethic would turn around. She just wanted to see his face one more time, but instead he sat facing forward, focused on the front of the courtroom. Alani examined the attorney Zaya had sent. She had studied his resume for hours the night before, reading about his unbelievable wins in prior court cases. His expensive suit and debonair persona were charming. The way he spoke was calming. She hoped it was a recipe for freedom, and she waited anxiously as he approached the podium to speak. Good morning, officers of the court. Jamal Bishop, lead counsel for the defense. I'd like to request that you waive the reading of the indictment against my client. Mr. Okafor has been provided with a written form of his charges. Due to the sensitive nature of the accused crime and the fact that his lovely wife and children are in attendance, we'd like to bypass that part. The judge looked down. A stern brow showed he was unmoved. Mr. Okafor, you've read the indictment and you understand the charges that have been brought against you? Ethic stood and Alani quivered. Even in state-issued clothing, his presence was felt. His authority, his dominance, it filled up the entire room. I do, he said. The judge glanced back over at the family and then waved his hand. Straight to the matter of bail, then. The prosecuting attorney piped up. The people ask for remand. Mr. Okafor is a violent threat to the community and has the financial means to flee. It would be a grave disservice to the victims' families and the community. This is a witch hunt. If you read the indictment, Your Honor, it reads like a grocery list. The prosecution is shopping, throwing everything in their cart until they find the one thing they can sell to a jury to convict my client. We don't need your grandstanding, Mr. Bishop. This is a pretrial hearing. Your showmanship is not required. Make it plain, the judge warned. Make it plain? Okay. The prosecution says letting Mr. Okafor out on bail would be going against the wishes of the victim's family. So let's let them speak for themselves. Come again? Ethic interrupted. Mr. Okafor, you will not speak out of turn in my court. I'm here. I'm the master, the judge chastised. Listen to the language of the judge. I'm the master. Nigga, you're the judge, motherfucker. You ain't the master of anybody. What was that? Ethic asked. His tone was deadly. He knew the games white men in black robes played with black faces. This courtroom may as well have been a slave field because judges were nothing more than overseers sitting up on their horses passing down punishments to black men. Excuse me, Mr. Okafor, the judge challenged. I need clarity on the way this master thing works. That will dictate what happens next, Ethic responded. Ezra! Alani's voice was like an extinguisher to his emblazoned soul. She stood from her seat and made her way to the podium as Ethic turned to steel in his chair. This is the victim's family, Your Honor, Bishop said, opening the swinging door that separated the audience from the lawyers, the mother of Kinsey Hill and sister to Lucas Hill. Shaky limbs carried Alani to the podium. She gripped the sides of the wood. She glanced back at Ethic. His elbows rested on the table in front of him. His hands were clenched. His head bowed on top of him. I need you to look at me, Alani said, turning to the defense table. When their eyes met, Alani felt her cheek go wet. This was the position they both had silently feared for years, the day when her mourning would no longer be hers to behold in the safety of her heart. Alani flipped through pictures of Kinsey in private every day, reminiscing alone so that her grief wouldn't bring a cloud over her entire household. Now, it was on a stage. This was the E&A show, and the crime of the week was murder, her baby's murder. Oh, how her heart ached. She knew he felt it because the gloss of his stare revealed that he shared her distress. He shook his head slightly. I need a second with you, Ethic said, turning his attention to his lawyer. We request a short recess, Your Honor. 10 minutes to discuss the course of action with my client, Bishop said. Court will recess for 10 minutes. Before Alani could utter a word to him, officers escorted Ethic away. Can I see him? Alani asked. You're about to speak on behalf of the victims. It's not a good idea to make it seem disingenuous or coerced by having you speak with him beforehand. I'll go, Morgan said. Please, I have to see him. Morgan stepped up. I just want to make sure he's okay. It wouldn't be a good idea for you to speak to him either. The inciting incident surrounds you. This is a unique circumstance. If it looks contrived in any way, it could cost him his life. I'll speak to Ethic, Nair said. No, Ezekiel interrupted. He's my son. I should. Alani felt helpless as Ezekiel walked out of the courtroom with Ethic's lawyer. She was his wife. She was supposed to be by his side, but she could tell he didn't want her there. Before his wife, she was a mother, and her motherhood trumped all. Was one of the greatest qualities that had made him love her. One role was pitted against the other and it made them enemies. And it's a break in the chapter. Child, listen, what the fuck is happening right now? Y'all remember we read this and I was like, what is happening right now? But because we hadn't read the book, we didn't know. But now, even though we know, it's still like, what the hell is happening right now, you know? I don't even understand. Sorry, y'all. All right. Ethic stood in the courthouse conference room, staring out of the barred windows. Son. The sound of Ezekiel's voice pulled his attention toward the door. Discomfort filled the space between them. Their relationship was fickle. Zeke had been a terrible father to Ethic, but he was atoning for that in the grandfather department. They both knew it was too late for parenting for Ethic, but he acknowledged the effort to connect with Bella and Easy. And this nigga got a whole lot of nerve, too. Ethic's father. Like, sir, what do you want? Tell me what you want, sir. I don't understand what he wants. I don't even understand why he's there. Everyone's on edge out there, Ezekiel said, but we're all here standing behind you, especially Lanika. That's some woman. Ethic was silent as he stared at his father. It felt too little too late, but the boy in him was tolerant of Zeke's presence, the part of him that overcompensated with his children to make sure they never felt the inadequacy he felt from his father's abandonment, was grateful for his presence. "She's my wife," Ethic said. "She can't do this. I'll plead guilty before I make her get up in front of the world and defend me." His lawyer entered the room and closed the door. "You need her. If she vouches for your innocence, it's a strong possibility that the judge and jury will too." Bishop pushed his agenda strong. He was a shark of an attorney who would do anything to win. "I won't play on her grief. I need to see her. I've got 7 minutes left. They belong to her," Ethic said. "You do realize the risk you take by not using her to speak on your behalf?" Bishop asked. "It'll break up. I took my time putting that woman back together. I won't break her again and leave her with the pieces," he said. It was an adamant no. "Mr. Okafor, I speak. You listen. No, this is the dynamic of this arrangement. Get my wife," Ethic said. Bishop nodded, biting his tongue, stopping himself from pushing more. He turned to exit. "I need you to check on Messiah Williams and Hendrix Outlaw," Ethic said. "Whoever has been assigned to their counsel, their services are no longer needed." "Amy Fisher has been retained for Mr. Williams," Bishop informed. Ethic was stunned. She was one of the tastemakers, in the legal system in Michigan. "Retained by who?" he asked, wondering who could have made the call to get her to take on a new client. She worked with a very select clientele. "And Ahmeek Harris arranged that," Bishop answered. Ethic nodded. "The nigga's solid. I'll give him that," Ethic whispered. "I'll work on Hendrix Outlaw. He's being repped by someone from the public defender's office," Bishop said. "Do all you can for him. Spare no expense. Tack the bill onto mine," Ethic informed, "and get my wife." Y'all, listen. It's another break in the chapter. So Ethic is trying to be a protector. Yeah, but why though? You need her. And this won't break her to say, hey, you know, let me speak. I don't even know what she could say, but like, I'm the family and I don't want him charged with nothing. This is all a huge mistake. Somebody else did it. It wasn't him. Mm-mm. That part. Like, I don't understand why she can't say. But I guess if we keep reading, we'll find out, right? I guess. He wants to see you. The news eased some of Alani's anxiety, and she breathed a sigh of relief, releasing Easy's hand. "Can we come?" Easy asked. "You can't. Not right now. But I'll be right back, baby boy. I promise," Alani said as Bishop ushered her away. "How long do I have with him?" she asked. "Only a few minutes," Bishop replied. "We have to make it quick." Alani followed him into the conference room, and as soon as she saw Ethic, her emotional dam burst. She rushed to him, and Ethic lifted his cuffed wrist to receive her, locking her inside his hold. He rested his chin on top of her head and closed his eyes. "I'm terrified, Ezra," she whispered. "I know, baby. I need you," she cried. "We all need you so much." She couldn't foresee a life without him. The notion was preposterous. "It isn't your place to defend me from this, Alani," he said. "I'll never compromise you in that way. It's my job to protect you, not the other way around. We don't speak about Kinsey often, but you know, I'm eternally sorry, Alani. I'm a ruined man behind that night." "I know you are." She looked up at him, caressing his face. "How did this happen to us?" "I don't know, but I'm going to find out. It isn't on you to defend me. You don't even have to be here. I took a lot of love to erase the way you used to look at me. Putting you in the middle of this will end us. Can't be here, baby." "Where else would I be?" she asked. She kissed his lips and he held her tighter before bringing his arms from around her. He dropped to one knee. Alani rubbed the top of his head, circling waves with manicured nails as he kissed her belly. "I feel like I'm losing you." Alani's voice barely existed. She didn't even want to speak it into existence, but it was true. Only 2 days had passed since his arrest. She felt like he would never come home again, like the last time. He had walked out the door had been the last time, and she hadn't appreciated it enough because she hadn't known she would be savoring it. "I need you strong, baby. I need Lanika," he said, standing. "If I don't make it home, I'm gonna die," she whispered. "Ezra, no." His thumb swiped at her tears. "We have to talk about it, baby," Ethic said. Her face was in his hands now as he covered it with love, her cheek first. The salt of the tears lingered on his lips as he moved to her chin, then her lips. "I don't want to." Her lips stretched and she lowered her head, defeated as she sobbed. "We have to." "You're not a killer." "I am," he answered. His answer was so matter of fact. She could tell he had prepared for this day and it angered her. How had he prepared but left her unprepared? "You're not," she defended. "I am. So do something. Kill everybody that's keeping you away from us," Alani sobbed. They spent every second they had absorbing this moment. I don't want to give birth without you, she said. You know what happened last time. I can't do it alone. He took her hands in his and lifted them to his lips. I'm going to be there. I'm going to give you your entire birth plan, baby, in a nasty ass pool in the middle of your $50,000 birthing room. Alani laughed through her tears. You going to get in with me? Ethic groaned. I'm going to get in the mucus water with you, Lanika. You better be there, she whispered, holding him tighter. I wouldn't miss it, he promised. Take care of my babies. Be strong. She nodded. When Bishop and the court officers entered the room, Alani and Ethic were forehead to forehead as Alani prayed aloud. The judge is waiting, Bishop said. Alani held him tighter and she cried a little harder, blowing out a breath of angst as she attempted to gather her composure. I love you so much, she said. Her eyes were clamped shut. Look at me, he commanded. They fluttered open. I love you. You're the best thing that ever happened to a nigga, Lanika. Mr. Okafor, step away, the officer said, reaching for Alani to separate them. You touch her, you die, Ethic said. Let's not keep the judge waiting further, Bishop said, stepping between the officer and Ethic. Mrs. Okafor can walk with us back to the courtroom. I can't see that doing any harm. We know she has no contraband since she was searched upon entry to the courthouse. The officer's temperament settled some as he took a step back. Ethic was escorted back to the courtroom and Alani walked behind him in the offices. She found her seat as the court proceedings resumed. Is the defense ready to proceed with the matter of bail? The judge asked. We are, Your Honor, Bishop answered. My client's wife is pregnant. She's due any day now. He is a doting father and family man. His entire family is here today on his behalf. He has young children. Certainly, you can reconsider letting this man go home to his family. He is no flight risk. To leave would be to leave them behind. He is a member of the community, as you can see. One of the most prominent officials in the city is here on his behalf. He has people who need him. It is a waste of taxpayer dollars to keep him locked up while the prosecution builds a shaky case against him. We request recognizance, Your Honor. Ezra Okafor may be an upstanding citizen, a reformed man, Your Honor, the prosecution said, but Ethic, the man who has flooded this city with cocaine and violence, is a criminal. The people ask you to keep our city safe and hold him on remand. I'd like to speak, Your Honor. Ethic's head whipped back at her, bewildered that she was changing the plan. He had said no. She had decided otherwise. The story of their entire marriage. Alani was the big boss. Because his heart beat at her command, it made her command the only word that mattered. The judge motioned for her to take the floor, and she stood to make her way to the podium. My name is Alani Okafor. Mr. Bishop, you don't take pleas of mercy from the defendant's family, the judge said. I'm the victim's mother, Alani said. Her voice broke. Ethic knew it would, knew she would. This was trauma on top of trauma. Alani's fists were tight as the pressure built in her. She felt like the worst kind of woman, the type who chose a man over her flesh and blood, over her child. She had judged women like that, half-assed mothers, putting their sons out to keep boyfriends satisfied, feeling like the man of the house. Sorry-ass mothers who sided with abusive boyfriends when teenage daughters screamed foul play. Alani would have been ready to slap a bitch like that, and here she was, a bitch like that. She wondered if other women gave the same excuses to make sense of the pain their men caused. Ezra's not like those men. He's a good man. It was a mistake, she thought. She was sure all the women she had judged over the years had told themselves that very same thing. Her throat was so tight she couldn't sip air. Breathe. She turned to him, just the sound of his voice, and it was like she had permission to exist again. Many women may justify their men's misdeed, but just staring in his eyes, Alani knew her justification was true. Sad, but true. The victim's mother, Alani said more confidently as she turned back to the judge. My brother and my daughter are the lives you're trying to find justice for. I want that, but not at the sake of Ezra Okafor. He's my husband, and I am 8 months pregnant. I need him home. We have three children and two grandchildren who need him home. My daughter lost her life. Do you think I'd be pleading on this man's behalf if I thought he was a bad man? Please grant bail so that if these are the last days we get to see him free, we'll get to be with him. Give him enough time to see his child be born into the world. Alani made her way back to her seat. Bail is set at $1 million, the judge said. I'm coming to get you, Ezra, Alani shouted as she watched the officers lead him out of the courtroom. I'm coming to get you. And that's the end of that chapter. Well, thank God she did say something. God damn it, man. Listen, Linda. Oh, my God. Because the prosecutor was like, Child, I hope he put a bullet in Bash's head. I hope he finds out that it was Bash and end his ass. Put the gun up his rectum and pull the trigger. Just ziplock the trigger so it don't fire. Oh, I cannot stand this dude, bro. We don't give a fuck about Bash because y'all know we don't know how Bash thinks and we don't know what's behind. I know what's behind how he's feeling, you know, from a clinical standpoint. Obviously, I know that professionally, right? But I'm saying in the book, Ashley does a very good job of not telling us, you know, what he's thinking at all. I wonder if it's, so thus far, we don't know shit about what Bash thinks. We know how he feels about Morgan, but we don't know why. We don't know his backstory. So we just view him as an asshole because, well, that's what the fuck he is. Child, listen. I don't even know at this point what to think. But I know that I don't like him. All right, let me get my time stamp for the next chapter. All right, I see StreamYard is on its bull today. Chapter 5. Morgan couldn't get Messiah off her mind. The thought of him locked up for reasons undeserving peeled back layers of her that had long been buried. Her heart pounded in anticipation as she wondered if his case would be called next. I have to get to the bank and then come back to process his bail, Alani said. What about Henny? Bella asked. We can't just leave. His mom won't come for him. I'm all he has. The passion in Bella's voice couldn't be mistaken. She was a young girl in love. Nothing outweighed that. There was nothing that would get her to leave Hendricks behind. Mo, can you stay here with her? We'll post his bond. I have to make it to the bank. I can't be in two places at once, Alani said. Bash, you can take the twins home, can't you? This will be a long day for us. They don't need to be here. No, they can stay with me, Morgan interjected. The idea of him home alone with her children terrified her. If he had changed with her, would he treat them differently? He had never hurt them before, but she had no way to know what he was capable of. That doesn't make sense. I'll take them to my family's home. You handle your business. We'll be there when you're done, Bash said. He kissed the top of Morgan's head and she turned to ice. Can I talk to you for a second before you leave? Morgan asked. She scooped Yara into her arms and held Masari's hand before following him into the hallway. Bash, they can stay with me. After last night, I don't want to let them out of my sight, Morgan said. Please just leave them. I swear to God, I'm not going to say anything. You don't have to use them as leverage. You have the power to take them. I heard you loud and clear. I don't plan to give you a reason to. Just let me keep my babies near me right now. I'm falling apart, she pleaded. Mo, you got to stop painting me as the monster. I've been here for them since the day they were born. You got to know they're safe with me. You come with your bullshit, but we raised these kids, Mo. You're trying to convince yourself that you did it alone, but I was there. My family and I have been putting these babies first since they entered our lives. Let me show you something, Bash said. He pulled out his phone and passed it to Morgan. There was a text exchange between him and an unsaved number. Only one short message appeared. Grant him bail. Morgan looked up at Bash in shock. Her fate was really his to toy with. The helplessness she felt was crippling. If she moved her piece across the board in the wrong direction, she would lose the game. I don't want to ruin you. This can get worse. Or you can be better. You can get it right. All this can go away. It can be simple, Mo, he said. Her lip quivered. Bash had been the reason Ethic was granted bail. That type of power was scary. How was she supposed to escape that type of hold? They had a long night. Let me take them home, reestablish some normalcy for them. They're safe with me. They always have been. You, on the other hand. I'll leave with you, Morgan said. Just give me a minute to tell Alani. There was no way she was letting him out of her sight with her twins. She wanted to stay. She desperately wanted to be near her family. She wanted to wait for Messiah's case to be called. She needed to see that he was okay, but she couldn't let Bash walk out of this building with her kids. She stepped over to her family. I have to go, Alani. The kids are restless and Yara's clinging to me more than usual after last night. I should get them home. I'm sorry, Morgan said. Alani was too consumed by her own turmoil to identify Morgan's. They were all just reacting to the possibility of life-altering change, trying to prevent the unfathomable from occurring. Okay, Mo, I'll call you as soon as Ethic is released, she said. And Messiah, Morgan whispered, call me as soon as you know something about him. Alani glanced over Morgan's shoulder, pausing long enough to stare Morgan in the eyes. Of course, Alani replied. Morgan turned to walk away, and Alani grabbed her hand. Hey, are you good? We're going to get them all out of here. We just got to stick together and be strong until they're home. This trial can't make us lose sight of how far we've come, Mo. I love you. We're in this together. Don't put me back on the other side. I don't want to go back to being someone you hate. Morgan nodded and placed a hand on Alani's belly. I don't want to be someone you hate either. Promise you'll never go back to hating me, she whispered, growing emotional as her chin quivered. Alani placed a flat palm beneath Morgan's chin. Never, Mo, like motherfucking ever, okay? Morgan nodded and then walked out of the courthouse. She prayed to have Alani as the voice of reason when her treason became known. She was the most well-versed of them all when it came to forgiveness. Morgan would need her to salvage her relationship with Ethic because she could feel it in her bones. The fallout was inevitable. This fucking girl, if she would have just fucking said something the other day, it's a break in the chapter, that's what I'm talking. I want to punch Morgan in the back of her fucking head. I don't know if there's a video on YouTube of a girl sitting at her desk in an office and she's singing. And this guy walks up behind her and whacks her in the back of her head with a phone book. And when I tell y'all, I that thing was put out there probably 15 years ago. That that's what I want to do to Morgan. I want to whack her on the back of her head with an old fucking Illinois Bell phone book. I bullshit you not. Hold on. Let me see if I can find it. Let me see. I dropped the link in the chat. Yes. Oh my God. It was 13 years ago. Oh my God. I don't even know how I can show it to y'all. And it's only like 16 seconds long. But this dude fucking whacks this girl in the back of her head. And he is, they the way this one is like a it's not the original. This one is kind of like a what do you call it? Like they make a they made like that stupid where they keep showing the same thing over and over again. That's not how it happened. The guy, he only hit her once, but they keep making that, what do they call it, a boomerang of it. So I don't even know where the original video is. But in the original video, she is sitting there singing at her desk. She probably worked in like a call center or something. And this dude gets up and walks up behind her. And when I tell you, he whacks this girl in the back of her head so hard. Just look up annoying girl hit in head with book. Because I don't know. Let me see. I don't know how to. But yeah, you'll see it. She's just sitting there singing, and this dude walks up behind her, and baby, he hits her in the back. That shit is fucking hilarious. And because the original video was a little bit longer, because she was sitting there for like maybe about 15 or 20 seconds just singing. And finally, the guy just can't fucking take it anymore. And he whacks the shit out of that girl. That fucking shit tickled me. I watched that shit almost as probably 10 times more than I watched the guy who tripped up the stairs carrying the McDonald's and then picked up the cup and just threw it at the damn. Mad you gotta be to pick up a drink that didn't waste and just fling it at the door and then kick the rest of the food off the porch? Yo, come on now. That's pissed. That is you are fuck you have fucking had it. You heard it. You are over it, like right now. All right, let me get back to this book because y'all didn't come here to hear about the shit that makes me tickled pink. All right. hours. Bella Okafor sat in the courthouse for hours waiting for Hendrix's name to be called. Zora sat beside her. They hadn't spoken very often. Bella was sucked into the trials and tribulations of the people who stood before the court, waiting to hear their fates. "This is terrible," she whispered. 90% of the people who came before the judge were black. Bella felt sick as she watched him hand down harsh sentencing or impossible bail amounts. "He's being way harder on the black people who stand in front of him," Bella said, voice low and in despair. "Auntie Zora, none of this is fair." "It never is, Bella," Zora said. "They may not arraign him today. Maybe we should head home. I can't leave him in here. Look around. His mom isn't here. If I'm not here, he'll feel alone, and he's not alone. I'd never leave him alone. I know people think I'm too young to know what love is, but I'm not. I really love him. He makes me feel like it's okay to be different from all the other girls. Like, I don't wear a bunch of makeup. My clothes aren't always tight, and my hair isn't always perfect. I started to think I had to do something to fit in on Susan Street, but then he made it okay for me to stand out. I want to make it okay for him to stand out too, to be the first one of his friends to go to college and just do something different. This isn't supposed to be his life." "That's beautiful, Bella," Zora replied. "Sometimes life throws you on a different path and you have to take a detour that makes it a little harder to get where you're going." "He'll get there though," Bella said, never taking her eyes off the front of the courtroom. "He has to." When Bella saw Hendrix finally emerge from the side door, relief flooded her. He was limping and dragging his cuffed feet as he looked at the ground in front of him. She just wanted him to look up at her, but he didn't. He kept his head down all the way to his seat. Bella didn't hear anything the entire arraignment, except that his bail had been set at $50,000. "So he can get out, right?" Bella asked. "That's what that means, right, Bishop?" Hendrix turned at the sound of a voice. He was a shell of his usual self. No charm, no smile, no sparkle in his eyes like when he normally looked at her. He just spun the swivel chair forward and focused on the cops that were forcing him to stand. They escorted him out and Bella's chest caved in. "Auntie Zoe, please get him out," Bella said. "We will. Come on. Let's go," Zora said, easing out into the aisle. "What about Messiah?" Bella asked. "That was the last case of the day, Bella. I don't know why they didn't call him, but he won't see a judge today." Zora approached Ethic's attorney. "Can you tell me when Messiah Williams will be arraigned? Sorry. Apparently, those charges have been dropped. I just got word. Makes me wonder what he gave up in return to be released." "Fuck you doing here?" Messiah asked as he emerged from the city jailhouse, days-old clothes weighing him down as he stared Livy up and down, then up again. In her eyes, her pretty-ass eyes, he might have been appreciative to see her if he hadn't known who had sent her. "Just doing Meek a favor," Livy said. "I don't need no favor, Shorty," Messiah said. "Yeah, well, how about a ride?" Livy asked. "He said you'd be difficult, but that you would know what needed to happen next and where to go." Messiah stalled because he did know. The crew didn't slip. They had a plan for everything, and all three of them knew it was time to blow town until things cooled off. "Really fucked you up in there," Livy said. "Come on." Messiah reluctantly followed Livy to her car. Meek was smart. He sent unsuspecting pussy into the police station after Messiah instead of risking his arrest by coming personally. The cops were playing a dirty game by not charging him. He would have to prove he hadn't flipped on Ethic, and if he skipped town, he knew it would make him look guilty. The cops were banking on it. They were setting a trap for Ethic to suspect Messiah of treachery to incite Ethic's wrath. If anything happened to Messiah, all roads would lead back to Ethic, and they would kill two birds with one stone. Messiah felt the pressure on his shoulders. He wasn't an indecisive man, but he didn't know what to do. He was silent as Livy drove him 40 minutes down I-75, pulling over at a motel, one that took cash only and had no cameras. They had mapped this place out years ago for instances just like these. He stepped out of the car, and Ahmeek opened the door to the room in front of their parking spot. He sauntered to the driver's side of the car and slid Livy a healthy stack of bandit bills, payment for her time and services. "Good looking," he said, as he leaned down against her window so that they were eye to eye. "You don't know shit, I? Last time you saw me was last night. You left the crib after a long night. The police come asking questions. You tell them everything we did until I got that call. Everything before that point is true. You won't forget it. You can recall that the same way again and again, no matter how many times you're asked. And what if they ask me what happens after that?" Livy asked. "You won't know because the cameras in my building caught you leaving in the middle of the night. You don't know shit else. You ain't heard from me since you left. You understand?" Livy nodded. "Where are you going?" she asked. Ahmeek tapped her lips, signaling for her to stop. No questions. Be careful, okay? Yep, he replied. Don't concern yourself with the bullshit, Liv. I'ma get with you soon, beautiful. He tapped the roof of the car and stood up straight as Libby reversed her car and drove away. Messiah and Ahmeek squared off, standing in the desolate parking lot. The energy between them was foreign, resentful. Neither knew what to say, but they were silently grateful for their mutual freedom. Messiah was bloody. The joyride had done a number on him. His shoulder felt like it was out of socket. His right eye was swollen, almost shut and blackened. He had bruises everywhere, a nasty gash behind his ear that had yet to stop bleeding. You good? Meek asked. The less you talk, what they fuck you up, Messiah said. I'ma be all right, though. I done been through worse. Meek nodded. These men were at an impasse. They had too much love between them to fully hate one another, but too much had been done to fully love one another. They were stuck, existing awkwardly, bound by loyalty that most wouldn't understand. Money's in the trunk. Miami been called. CJ say we can post up down there. They got the condos in dummy names, cars with new plates, all that. A whole new setup waiting for us until these motherfuckers get the targets off our backs, Ahmeek said. They handling some business in Houston, but everything's ready in Miami. They rolling out the red carpet. Issa's already on the road. I'll go a different way, though. Miami ain't feeling like the move for me, but everything is set up. Ain't no risk down there for you or Issa. Messiah knew Meek well enough to know that he no longer trusted him. If his freedom were on the line, he wouldn't put it in Messiah's hands. Not after the hit Messiah had called on his life. Time had truly changed their dynamic. Meek had elevated. He had bossed all the way up, secured the block, and gotten in bed with Hack. It was exactly what Messiah would have done had he been around to put the next job on the table. Meek had kept the crew eating and the money flowing in. In fact, it was overflowing. His only misstep over the past few years had been to fall in love. Messiah knew how it had happened. He knew why it had happened. If there was ever a girl to love, surely Morgan Atkins was it. He still hated it. He still resented him for discovering the mystery of her love. I can't leave town again, Messiah said, breaking the silence. I just found out about him. Last time I broke out, I lost everything. My kids here, another nigga raising what's mine. I can't leave. I hear that, Ahmeek said. Messiah nodded. Cops trying to throw dirt on my name. They want Ethic to think I snitched. I don't know that nigga too good, but what I know is that he know you ain't talking, Ahmeek answered. Do we? Messiah asked. I ain't got the best track record of loyalty with homie. You wouldn't be alive if he thought otherwise. He left you with your life because he loves you. The nigga put a hole in me for less, Meek said. Messiah nodded. Popo gonna put me back on that hook. They know about Lucas, the little girl. The nigga I stomped out at the club. They got every bone, man. If they can't get Ethic, they gonna bury me, Messiah said. So, move smart, Ahmeek said. Ahmeek tossed Messiah a car key to the rental car he had arranged. Then he walked over to the rental secured for himself. This the end of an era, ain't it? Messiah asked before Meek opened the door. Ahmeek shook his head. Nah, I think it ended a long time ago when you left the first time. You just missed the goodbyes, Ahmeek said. A solemn they had never felt consumed them. Keep your head above the dirt, Meek said. And your body free. Messiah finished. Both men uttering words they had said to one another many times. That had been the motto. Get money, stay breathing, ride free. Messiah felt a heaviness in his chest that he couldn't contain as Meek climbed in the car and drove away. And it's a break in the chapter. Child, listen. I don't even fucking get what's happening right now. What's taking them so long? Easy asked. Uncle Nye should be back with Daddy by now. It just takes a little time, big man, that's all. Daddy will be starving when he gets here. Why don't you help me fix dinner? Grab the green beans out of the bag and snap the ends, Alani instructed. She couldn't help but keep herself busy. She had spent too many days doing nothing but wallowing in the absence of her husband. She had to make use of her hands, of herself, because with Ethic gone, Alani felt useless. Easy sat at the kitchen table and grabbed the bowl of beans and began snapping. It was a routine he had grown used to while working in Alani's garden. Alani couldn't help but smile because Easy's anxiety was tamed by the repetitive chore. She was able to manage what doctors had advised medication for with pure love. Easy's ADHD was tackled in the hands of Alani because she refused to let anyone label him. A mother's love was all he had been missing, and she was so honored to provide that, but he needed his father too. And the thought that he may not be there was crippling. Bella, can you call Mo again? Alani asked. Morgan is going to turn up when Morgan turns up. She knows Ethic is coming home. She'll be here for him, Nanny fussed. If anybody loves him more than you, it's that narrow-tailed, hard-headed girl. So stop worrying yourself and get off your feet before you have that baby right here on the kitchen floor. Make me call your midwife. He's been away for 2 days, Nanny. If you think I'm letting him come in this house without a warm meal, you got another thing coming, old lady, Alani replied. He gonna want something warm, all right. It ain't gonna be nothing you can put on the stove, Nanny said, snickering. What? Easy asked. Pie, Nanny said, finding amusement in her inside joke as she gave a hearty laugh. Bella looked up from her phone for the first time since arriving home and erupted in laughter. Alani blushed and shook her head, laughing. Stop it, old woman, Alani said, tickled to tears. What's so funny? Easy asked. Nothing, boy. You wouldn't understand, Bella said. And it bothers me that you understand, Alani said. Come take this cornbread out of the oven. Yes, ma'am, Bella said, lifting from her seat. Can we eat? Easy asked. No, not until your father walks in this house. We fix his plate first, Alani said. They were words she would eat because 2 hours passed and then still no sight of Ethic. Even Nair's phone was going to voicemail. Where are they? Alani asked. No one in particular. Why don't we eat? Let the kids go to bed. We're not eating without him, Alani said. She was emotional, and the angst sitting on her shoulders made waiting unbearable. Kids, go fix your plates and take them upstairs. Don't leave them plates up there, you hear me? Nanny fussed. Yes, ma'am, Easy answered. When Bella and Easy were out of sight, Alani planted her face in her palms. I feel helpless, Nanny. They're asking questions I can't answer. Even when he gets home tonight, how long will he stay home? This is just bail. It's temporary. What if they lock him up? What if I have to testify? What do I say? Do I lie? Who do I protect, my baby or my husband? Do I do what's best for the baby I'm carrying or the baby I was forced to bury? Locking Ezra up doesn't feel like justice. I know he did it. I know I'm crazy for loving him anyway, but he's not a monster. Locking him up won't make it better. It'll just be pain on top of pain. I know you want me to give you the answers, baby, but I don't have them. You gotta give it to God, Nanny said. God be on that bullshit, Alani dismissed. Her entire life, she had been taught to trust God's plan, and oftentimes she strayed from him because she couldn't understand why she had to endure so much as a young girl. This was one of those times of confusion. Ezra asked for forgiveness. The man stood in front of an entire church and got baptized. He's repented. He's different. He believes, and still he's punished. That don't sound like God. God's will ain't for you to understand, little girl, Nanny said. And I know you love the man's dirty draws, but Ethic can't change God's will either. Trust in the Lord, Alani, not to prevent the storm, but to make sure you're covered while it rains. He won't ever put more on you than you can bear. Alani shook her head. That's laughable. I reached my breaking point a long time ago. I can't take any more. Well, baby, you signed up for this when you chose that man. All that breathe, Lanika, don't come without some heartache, too. A man like Ethic bringing plenty of heartaches one way or another. You knew what and who he was, so you have to endure his trials and tribulations. They were always coming. That's the one thing about the world. Always brings your crap back to you. Everything comes full circle. Nanny arose from her seat. Let me go wake Mr. Larry up so he can take me home, Nanny said, making her way to the living room. You don't want to stay? Alani asked. I want to sleep in my own bed. You and Ethic like to pretend like I live here. I like my house and my own space. I love Easy to death, but that boy too loud in the mornings. I need some peace and quiet sometimes. Nerves get bad when you get my age. All that racket will drive you to the madhouse. Alani scoffed as she watched Nanny make her exit. Call me in the morning. I'm sure Ethic will be home by then. Try not to worry yourself sick. You gotta think about them babies over everything. As terrified as you are, they are feeling 10 times that. Ezra doesn't need you to be his strength. He needs you to be theirs. Huh. Big facts, Nanny. As the night grew long and the house stilled, Alani feared the worst. She laid on the couch, placing a pillow between her thighs to ease the pressure of her belly as she waited impatiently. Something had to go wrong, she whispered. She forced her eyes open for as long as she could before her exhaustion took her under. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen, Alani like me. Child, when either one of these niggas go to the store, I'd be like, oh God, what is taking so fucking long? I made a goddamn list. Like, come on. They ain't answering. They ain't calling. Like, come on. I don't understand why it's taking so long. They be in the fucking store dilly-dallying, trying to decide, do she want a big bottle of this shit or do she want a little bottle? Then you learn, get the 8-ounce bottle. If they don't have the 8-ounce bottle, then you can get whatever size bottle they got, okay? Because listen, men go pick up what's on the list. But once they learn you, they try to figure out what you need, right? Well, I know she usually likes to buy the 16-ounce bottle, but I don't see that. So do I get nothing or do I get... like, come on? Like, it don't take all day. But anyway, let me get this next time stamp, child, because this chapter's 13 minutes. And technically, child, I talked up a whole lot of my time anyway, so whatever. But we're still stopping at 2 hours. Chapter 6. Mommy, where were you? Yara signed as Morgan went down on her knees so that she was at eye level with her babies. Mommy just wanted you to spend a little time with your dad, Morgan whispered and signed. Him is Miki's best friend. Miki said him is cool, Masari said excitedly. Him not cool, though. Him mean. Morgan shook her head. He only seems mean because you don't know him yet. He loves you, and he'll never be mean to you. He's going to save you from everything that hurts. He's your superhero. He can't save me, but he will save you and your sister one day. Why can't he save you too, Mommy? Yara signed. He just can't, baby, she signed. It's because him got tooken, Yali. Him can't come, Masari said. Shh, Morgan said, swiping a runaway tear. We can't talk about that right now, okay, baby? Morgan said, looking over her shoulder as Bash's footsteps echoed off the tile floor in the hallway. They were getting closer, and Morgan desperately wanted to change the conversation. Why not? Masari asked. We just can't. Tell Mommy a story, a really good one. Best bedtime story you can imagine, Morgan said. Can you do that? It'll make Mommy sleep so much better. Her voice was shaking and her heart pounding as she tried her best to hide her trepidation from her kids. Masari nodded and his hands started moving. He signed beautifully, getting stuck on a few words that he was still learning, but Morgan had no worries. She knew he would eventually become fluent. Once upon a time, there was a princess named Mommy, he signed. Morgan laughed. Her sweet boy always knew what to do to bring her joy. It was the absolute best perk of being a young mother. There were smiles that only Masari and Yara could pull from her because she could identify little pieces of love from Messiah in them. There were moments shared between the three of them that only DNA could explain, like when Yara rubbed her thumb and pointer finger together when she was angry or frustrated, or the way Masari's forehead wrinkled whenever he was focused on one thing for too long. Messiah came out of them in the most subtle ways, and even in her darkest days when she hated him, she loved him too because he had given her two babies that kept her alive. Oh, really? I think I know someone by that name, she said. It's you, silly, Yara sighed. No, I think the princess is you, baby, Morgan answered. Bash cleared his throat behind her, and Morgan didn't turn to him. Her head bowed for a beat as she took a deep breath and squeezed her twins' hands. Okay, in bed, Mommy's sorry. We can finish the story tomorrow. It's late, she signed. Morgan tucked her children under $1,000 sheets and pulled the duvet to their chests. I love you, Masari. I love you, Yali. Morgan turned off the light and made sure to turn on the bathroom light before meeting Bash at the door. It's been a long night for everybody, he said. She nodded. She was unsure of what to say or do. He reached for her face and Morgan pulled back. I just need a minute, she said. She walked by him, closing the twins' door as she made her way across the hall into another room where she would sleep. She prayed he slept somewhere else. The bathroom was her sanctuary, and as soon as she locked the door, Morgan felt safe enough to release her tears. She muffled her cries with one hand. This is too much, she thought. She removed her shirt, wincing in pain as she looked down at her battered body. It had taken all she had to pretend to be okay all day. Something felt broken inside her, her heart, her ribs. The pain was bearable but agonizing all at the same time. She ran a warm bath and poured bath salts inside, hoping to take away some of the aches. She slid inside the water, crying out in pain until she was submerged. She didn't know if the bath was soothing or if she just needed it as an excuse to be away from Bash, but she spent an hour in the tub. It didn't matter. Bash was waiting on the other side of the door for her when she came out. Morgan noticed her bags had been brought up, and she rummaged through them, pulling out leggings and a t-shirt. She turned toward the bathroom, but Bash's voice stopped her. me see your stomach, he said. It's fine, she replied. I'm fine, Dash. I apologize. Let me just make sure nothing's seriously wrong, he said as he came up behind her. The kiss to the back of her shoulder made her cringe. I could see you were in pain today. Morgan turned to face him. I promise I'm good. Can you just, I don't know, I'm just tired and afraid and overwhelmed, Bash. Can you just let or get me some water? I just feel like I can't breathe, like I don't know you. You know me. I'm the same person who was there the day you delivered the twins. The same one who massaged your feet when they were swollen. The same one who helped you study at 3 a.m. when you had tests to wake up to. And the same one who took night shifts so you could get rest, Mo. I only lost my way because you lost yours. This ain't how we have to be, Bash said. Why can't you just give this a chance? She was crying and her face was in his hands. Her stomach was twisted in discomfort and regret. I know I've done you wrong. I've done a lot of people wrong. I don't want people to hurt because of you or because of me. Not you, not anybody, she replied. Stop crying, Mo. I'm going to go get Tylenol for the pain. Then we'll talk about how we come back from this, Bash said. Morgan nodded, and as soon as he exited the room, she threw on her clothes and then went to her bag, searching for her phone. What the fuck? Where is it? She asked. Bash came back into the room, and Morgan stopped searching, sitting on the bed, feeling as if he had busted her red-handed. She had an eerie feeling that he had taken her phone, and she dreaded what was to come if he read her messages. Text threads between she and Ahmeek played back in her mind. Things they had said, pictures they had sent. Morgan had exposed more than her heart in that phone. Her body and soul were within the text threads of their messages. If Bash read them, it would be like gasoline to a fire. Ahmeek would be next to be arrested. And Morgan wasn't quite sure what threat Bash would make good on when it came to her. Here, Mo, he said. He handed her the bottle of Tylenol and a glass of orange juice, and Morgan took them, praying it would ease the throbbing in her midsection. You don't get to leave me after everything I've done for you. He said it so plainly, like he hadn't just shattered every notion of her future she had built up in her mind over the past few months. Why would you want me after all this? She asked. She was drained. All her fight was gone. She had done what the fairy tales had taught her to do. She had followed her heart, not once, but twice, and it had led her here. So fuck it. Why fight it? Why fight Bash when she knew how it would end? She would lose. She always suffered the greatest losses. This one didn't even surprise her. Perhaps that's why she had moved so recklessly, loving Ahmeek so boldly, so loudly, without apology. Had she known all along that he wouldn't be someone she could keep? Had she known that about Messiah too? Had the greatest loves of her life been mere lessons? Morgan didn't even recognize Bash. He hadn't always been like this. She had pushed him to this. One too many instances of disrespect had gotten them to this place. Morgan remembered the days of sitting with Raven, watching her cover bruises and pretend not to be hurt. Pretend to be happy. Morgan never thought that would become her. Her head was spinning as Bash leaned over, sweeping her hair off her neck, his lips on the softest part of her neck, and Morgan jerked away. It's been 2 years. You think I don't want you? I think about it all the time, Mo, he said. Bash, stop, she said. Morgan stood and the entire room rotated. She reached out, unable to steady herself. I bet you he didn't give her motherfucking Tylenol either. She grabbed nothing but air as Bash caught her. It was like she was trying to get through a fog. She was moving in slow motion and her legs felt like logs. Take it easy, Mo, Bash said, moving her to the bed. What did you give me? Morgan asked. She could barely hold her head up as he accosted her. She felt the air hit her nipples as he lifted her shirt. They stiffened and Morgan felt nauseous because she didn't understand why her body responded to him. The saliva he left behind felt like icicles when the air met her skin. She peeled his fingers off her body every time, pushing him away, trying to free herself of his hold. His grip was so tight, it felt like he was digging holes in her skin. Relax, Mo, he said. Every place he touched felt dirty, like his fingertips were left behind, leaving evidence of this night behind. Stop, Bash! Her voice felt small, even though it echoed in her mind. She felt like she was screaming, but he barely reacted. Christiana was home. She wasn't interrupting, so she couldn't have been loud. Morgan felt like she was screaming for her life, but he wasn't stopping. Her arms felt numb, and she couldn't quite get them to move. She felt him smell spit on her skin as he left trails of wet kisses along her body. Morgan was horrified. She had felt this before, the disgust, the shame, the feeling of filth that men left behind when they touched her without love. Lucas had made her feel like this that night all those years ago. It was like she was frozen, stuck in a time when she had misunderstood. when others couldn't understand her, and when she didn't even have a voice to say no. Bash couldn't hear her. He didn't understand her no. Was she even saying it? Morgan couldn't tell anymore, and when he entered her, may as well have detonated a mental bomb. She felt everything and nothing all at once. Morgan had known this moment would happen between them eventually. It had been 2.5 long years of waiting, of patience, of her making excuses. He had been more than understanding. His tolerance had run out. It felt like she was watching this scene play out instead of living it, like she was out of her body and trying to fight Bash, push him, pull him, punches flying, feet kicking, anything to get him off. But in reality, she lay paralyzed because her body didn't work. She felt trapped as her silence permitted him to keep going. His lips were everywhere, his tongue doing everything, hands staining parts of her body he had never touched. Those babies he wanted to make, the ones he had tormented Ahmeek with at the dinner table during her graduation, the ones she was sure would enslave her to this lifestyle and this man forever, she felt them spill into her. Tears melted out of the corners of her eyes as he finished. You don't play with a man's emotions. Ethic's voice echoed in her mind. She had done exactly that, and now she was paying the ultimate cost. He hovered over her, inside her, moving her hair out of her face as he realized she was crying. No, 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 don't cry. You think I want to hurt you? I don't want to hurt you. The other men hurt you. I just want to have you. I just want to kiss you, he whispered as he pressed his lips to hers. Just let me kiss it, Mo. Morgan pushed against his chest weakly, anger building in her that she couldn't let out. No, Bash, please. Oh, she sobbed. This can't happen to me again. He put his tongue in her mouth and Morgan cringed. Why didn't she bite that motherfucker? She moved her head to the side and felt tears leak out of her eyes as he initiated round two. I'm done waiting, Mo. Just give it to me, Mo, he moaned. See? It's good, baby. It's so good. Damn, you feel good. Nothing. Morgan felt nothing. He stroked her slowly as he pinned her hands above her head with one hand. Damn, Bash called out. You owe me, Mo. You owe me. Damn, just let me get it. Another man with the power to take what he wanted. He put a hand around her throat and squeezed as he had his way again. Ali, you feel so good, he whispered. No, he said, Ali, you feel so good, he whispered. Ali, it was the look in his eyes that told her he wasn't even in the room. His mind was somewhere else, and the more into it he became, the tighter his grip around her throat became. Bash! Morgan could barely get his name out. He was squeezing the life out of her. His hands just kept tightening. He squeezed harder and harder the more into it he became. His hips dove so deep into her that the bed moved across the floor with every stroke. Air, there was none. Her vision blurred, transforming him into a distorted image of himself like something terrifying. A monster. This was the boogeyman that would terrify her for nights to come. She didn't even recognize the man on top of her. Morgan felt like bullets entered her when he came. He climbed off and began to adjust his clothes as Morgan struggled to lift her body weight. She couldn't do anything but roll onto her side. She hadn't felt this out of it ever. A few drunken nights out with Stiletto Gang had come close, but nothing ever this debilitating. Her mouth was dry, like it was stuffed full of cotton balls. They were getting stuck in her throat. I can't breathe, she thought, panicking. It isn't that bad, Morgan. Loving a regular man, having a regular life. What I'm offering is good for you. It's good for our kids, he said. Bash, please help me, she cried, lying there, watching him dress so normally as if he hadn't just violated her. She had never felt so naked. He had stripped her without even using aggression. Men like Bash were the worst with their entitlement, their money, their manipulation. He didn't need bravado because he had bank, and his big bank trumped her little bank every time. Morgan felt numb as he squatted beside the bed. You're emotional right now. You need to sleep. You'll feel fine by morning. We both have done some things we aren't proud of tonight. You said some things you don't mean because surely you don't want Ethic to sit in a prison cell for the rest of his life. You know that's what's going to happen if you leave me. We will get back on track, Morgan. You see Ahmeek or Messiah again, and I'll make sure they share a cell right beside Ethics. I give you my word. Bash spoke calmly and kissed the top of her head. One thing about you, Mo, it isn't overrated. He walked out, and Morgan passed out, giving in to the overwhelming urge to make everything go away. And that's the end of that chapter. Yep, he is definitely a psychopath. All right, y'all. I told y'all I was going to slow walk this one. I hope they fucking kill him. I hope she tells them and they kill him, kill him, kill him, kill him, motherfucker. Oh my God. Why am I like this? Child, listen. I'm tripping. I just got an email from somebody. Hold on, y'all. Okay. Like, that's weird. Okay. Sorry. I don't understand. And it'd be the audacity of people to just send you fucking emails. Like, what the fuck? All right. Y'all be careful, the websites y'all visit, bro, because shit is real. All right. Yeah, you go to people's websites and y'all listen. If you don't, you know, fool with the person, if you don't know the person, don't be going to these strange websites because, you know, like signing up for shit. Yeah, be careful. Because that was fucking spam. I'm like, what the fuck is that? Like, I don't know. But anyway, all right, you guys, this was fun, and I hate to leave it on such a horrible fucking note, but yeah, I'm gonna get out of here. I'm coming back. I'm gonna set the girl, me too, Nequetta. Boo, why they not out putting a bullet in this nigga dome right now? Oh my God. Listen, the only character I think I have disliked more is that rancid bitch in that other book, Dirty to the Grave. Listen, Linda. That's the only one that I think her and Dash, she and Dash are neck and neck. Yeah, they're neck and neck for the level of disdain that I have for them. Like, for real, yo. I can't. If you ain't listened to that book, go over there and listen to that book. Dirty to the, I forgot who it was that recommended that book. I think it was that Kim Cash that recommended that book, or was that Treacy Cakes, who used to come in here, child. People stop coming to the Speakeasy for the weirdest fucking reasons. People be misinterpreting and misunderstanding. And I think you can miss easily, or you can easily misunderstand somebody because you already feel a way about them anyway. If another bitch can turn you against somebody, you was already feeling that way anyway. You know, if another bitch that you don't know can turn you against another bitch that you're getting to know, and you know that they don't know that person like that, well, you dumb. Because I don't let people make decisions for me. I find out for myself. I may not have to experience them the way that you have, right? I may not have to go through with them what you have, but you know, I can feel what the fuck they giving up, you know. Don't let other people determine, you know, who you fuck with and who you don't fuck with. You decide on your own. You know, everybody on this motherfucker grown for the most part. You know, so if somebody can turn you against somebody, child, you a fucking weirdo, and you was just looking for a reason any goddamn way. Cause, child, don't nobody on YouTube know me. Shit, Love Jones. That's it. But don't nobody know me like that. No, trust me. Don't nobody know me like that. Some of y'all are getting to know me because I've allowed you in. But yeah, no ma'am. So anyway, yeah, so I think it was either Kim Cash or Treacy Cakes. And like I said, Treacy Cakes don't come over here no more. And that was a real weirdo move, but y'all, life goes on. So I think I forget which Speakeasy episode that was, but y'all listen, it is a heifer in that book, Dirty to the Grave. Nigga. Oh my God. That girl. I was like, man, fuck this book. I was losing it over there. I was like, why the fuck am I reading this thing? Oh my God. I was so mad. I was livid about that book. Just because y'all know I'm real big on Black women uplifting each other. Like some Black women, you just ain't gonna be able to fucking help no matter what. They just, you know, stained with too much trauma and they're not seeking help. And so because of that, you know, because you're untrained, you're not going to be able to help them. And unless they seek out therapy, you know, ain't no therapist gonna just walk up and ring your fucking doorbell. You know what I'm saying? Like you have to seek out the help. It's not that they can't be helped. They can if they seek the help. But you can't be healed unless you seek healing. And some people, child, look in the mirror and are perfectly okay with the motherfucker staring back at them. And yes, you're supposed to love yourself, but you're also supposed to want to be better today than you were yesterday. And you should be excited about being better tomorrow than you are today. You know, and I know your mom and them didn't teach you that or whatever, but listen, y'all be researching these motherfucking celebrities. Research healing your goddamn self. Right? Research that. You know, because I sit here on YouTube hiding in plain sight for motherfuckers that are looking to find out, well, who is Saki, girl? Oh my God. Ask the people that have had speakeasy sessions. Ask my clients. Ask them. They'll tell you because they know. Therapy works, y'all. It really, really does work. All right? So listen, I'm about to get out of here. I hate to leave it on such a horrible note, but God damn that fucking bash. Told y'all, Black men will do whatever. And he was willing to drug that girl and literally assault her. Mm-hmm. In order to get what he wanted. And they ain't even married yet. So, yeah. She doesn't even have full autonomy over her own body anymore. Child, let me tell you something. If you think I wouldn't be telling Ahmeek and Messiah and Issa and Ethic to put a bullet in his ass, I don't give a damn about his threats about, oh, if something happened to me. Kill the mama first and let him know, yo, daddy next, nigga, and then you. Just grab them all up and just end them all. How about that? Oh. I hope she is not, I don't know. If she writing that this girl is going to just repeatedly be undergoing this shit, mm-mm. But you see the type of shit, the type of nigga that Christiana raised? A whole motherfucking offender. That's what he is, a whole fucking offender. Mm-hmm. That's what he is. He needs to be on the registry. That's two crimes he committed right there. She's not his wife. And no means no. I don't give a fuck, even if we are married. I'd be running to the police station, but she's so goddamn scared and confused, and he know it. Yeah, you know what? I thought about that, and I was hoping that we would find out, right? But knowing Ashley, child, she probably won't even expound on that. She probably won't, because like she write it, but I think she be forgetting as she moved from one book to the other, because the girl be writing so many goddamn books. Like she can't remember all that shit. But I would have me a little, anyway, yeah. So I wonder if it was a girl that got away or one that he fucking killed by drugging her. Like this nigga didn't just become this way. He been this way. Like these men don't become predators. You know, just one day something happened and flip a switch. This nigga been a predator. He set his eyes on Morgan because she probably looks like this girl Allie. That's what it is. And he probably been like that since he was a little ass boy. Little weird ass nigga. Mm-hmm. He a fucking weirdo, a creep stain. Y'all know that's my word. So if you hear it somewhere else, please know that that's mine. I told the story about where it came from. He's a creep. Oh my God. All right. So listen, I'm going to get out of here. Finally, I'm about to go. All right. Thank y'all for listening to me read out loud. Thank you, Love Jones, for being such a wonderful moderator and such an annoyingly wonderful little sister. You do your jobs well, dear. Thank you. All right, listen, y'all. I'll be back Wait, Kate, not to set squirrels on fire. You said, what is it? Again, we need to have a convo for real. Girl, hit me up in the DMs on, I'm about to say on YouTube. Ain't no DMs on YouTube, bitch. It's on Oh my God. Listen. Yeah, he bashes a whole nut. All right. Listen, I know y'all about to travel the highways and byways of the YouTube verse. Please look both ways before crossing the street because there's loose drivers at the wheel. And I love y'all. And I want y'all to make it back to the speakeasy in one session. Okay. All right. Look for the thumbnail because I'm going to put it out here as soon as this is over with. And listen, y'all. If you do nothing else, please salute your spirit and protect your peace. Until next time, bye, y'all. Thank you.